Stuxnet. 15,000 lines of code that achieved what no diplomat, spy, or conventional weapon of war was able to do. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the age of cyber warfare, an age that officially began 10 years ago with a weapon that changed the rules of the game for good, a computer virus capable of disrupting physical infrastructure on the other side of the world. That virus's name? Stuxnet. 15,000 lines of code that achieved what no diplomat, spy, or conventional weapon of war was able to do. Covertly slow down the uranium enrichment process in Natanz, Iran. Who developed Stuxnet? Many will tell you Israel and the United States were behind it. The same people will also say, yes, they deserve a round of applause. That's absolutely right. Absolutely right. And many people will tell you that it took years to design, develop, deploy, and deliver to its intended target. But if you ask me, the people behind Stuxnet, we may never know their names, but they might actually be worthy of their chance for a Nobel Peace Prize. After all, it was their actions that probably prevented a much more lethal form of conflict. And it's not that counterintuitive if you consider the fact that Alfred Nobel himself had invented dynamite, amongst other things. Stuxnet was important not just because of how it changed history, but also because it opened the floodgates for an unprecedented decade of Israeli cybersecurity innovation. Each year, thousands and thousands of young Israelis are released into the wild after serving time in the IDF technology and intelligence units, just like I did. Fueled by the glory of Stuxnet, and by generous investments, of course, they go on to create some of the world's most successful and innovative cybersecurity companies. But Stuxnet was also important for another reason. It showed us that we are now in a different era of cyber warfare, one where viruses are not just after our information, our passwords, our secrets. It's no longer about stealing credit card numbers. Cyber attacks in this decade are about physical destruction. They're about data manipulation. They're about attacks that we have witnessed on energy systems, on transportation hubs, on healthcare providers, with attacks like the ransomware epidemic that disrupted the United Kingdom's national healthcare services just 3 years ago, and even attacks on the core of democracy, the political process itself. So in simple words, the future of cybersecurity isn't about secrets anymore. It's about trust. And it's about the trust that we place in the modern digital society, the one that we wish to live in. And you know, this trust can be at risk more often than not. 200 years ago, it was German war historian and philosopher Karl von Clausewitz who said, "War is simply the continuation of politics in other means." Well, it appears that nowadays, in the 21st century, cyber war is the continuation of politics in other means. And in this kind of war, everybody is on the front line, not just military targets. So it is time to redraw the battle lines between companies and corporates, between cyber criminals and hacktivists. We're all in this together. It affects each and every one of us, and nobody is immune. In fact, even here in Israel, in the startup nation, in the cyber power of the world, this week we learned that the personal details of 6.5 million Israelis were exposed, all because of an unsecured voting campaign ad, an app developed by the leading political party. Just imagine the entire Israeli voter database exposed because of the digital equivalent of somebody leaving the keys to the kingdom under the doormat. This proves that if data is the new oil, as we continue to mine more data, to aggregate more data, we must be very mindful that we don't also create toxic assets and data spills, especially if you experience a data breach of this magnitude. This teaches us a very important lesson for the future. So where do we go from here? It seems very scary. It seems nobody is safe. And yes, we will see more ransomware viruses, more malware attacks, and more types of evolved threats that we'll have to deal with. We'll also see attackers targeting not just our computers, our apps, or our web servers. They're also going after the many digital devices that we share our lives in. As you heard before, we're living in a truly expanding digital universe. With a hand on your heart, what do you have at home? More digital devices or family members and pets? Most people have more digital devices, and that's how the future is going to look like. According to the Munich Security Conference, this year, 2020, is officially the year that planet Earth, our home, is home to 3 times more digital devices than human beings. And that trend is only going to continue exponentially. That means we have to redefine our visions of cybersecurity, our visions of secrets, what we choose to protect, and how we choose to protect it. And of course, with AI, automation, and advances in machine learning, attackers and defenders will be locked into an ever-evolving cyber arms race. What do we do about it? And as we focus on innovation, we are told that software is eating the world. In fact, even my dress has HTML code on it. It's everywhere. Startups are told to move fast and break things. And with all of that innovation, how can we make sure that the things we create, the new technologies, are secure for the future and for our legacy? I believe it's time for a digital immune system for this new age. And the surprising fact is, hackers like me can help. In recent years, hackers and security researchers have identified, developed, and fixed thousands of security problems. Indeed, in my TED talk, I introduced the idea that hackers can be a part of that important immune system for the digital age. And many have agreed with it. In fact, hundreds of companies are now working with hackers, from brand names and retail giants to Silicon Valley pioneers. What these companies all have in common is the fact they have something called a bug bounty program. This allows them to work with individual hackers from all over the world. Hackers that once were delegitimized now can work legally with these organizations. You know, it was quite often that people would overestimate hackers' malicious motivations and underestimate our ethics. And it's time to really change our thinking about that assumption. Companies like Tesla, for example, have decided to work with hackers to identify flaws in their car, in their hardware, in their software, in all of their features. And the top hackers that can demonstrate finding a vulnerability in a Tesla, they can walk away with a new car, perhaps, or they can achieve one of these medals, a challenge coin, only awarded to the top hackers that work with Tesla each year. Another organization decided that this is a good idea, working with friendly hackers. That organization, the Pentagon. The United States Department of Defense launched the first of its kind program to work with friendly hackers in 2016. From the moment they launched the program until they received their first valid vulnerability report, all it took was 13 minutes. 13 minutes. What about the days, weeks, months that vulnerability was out there? Bad guys, criminals, spies, and terrorists don't require an invitation, and they won't respond to one either. So who does? The new heroes of the digital age. And yes, hackers might look funny, our hair is a little different, we might dress in alternative fashions. That doesn't mean we're the bad guys. It means we're the security professionals this world needs. And according to many industry workforce reports, this is not a job that's going to go away. The world needs a million more security professionals, at least. And they're going to come from all walks of life, from all ethnicities, from all genders, from all backgrounds. And they will come from some of the unlikeliest places there are. For example, the Girl Scouts. The United States Girl Scouts program now teaches girls of all ages cybersecurity skills because they believe that's an important skill set for the future and for the communities in which these Girl Scouts operate. That's why here in Israel, I started 2 nonprofit organizations in the past few years. One is called Leading Cyber Ladies, and it's a growing community for women in cybersecurity. We started in Tel Aviv, but we now have branches in the United States and Canada. And thousands of women in cybersecurity are learning from one another and building their professional skills. Thank you. Thank you so much. And this is a nonprofit initiative. I also started Israel's largest hacker community conference. Yes, hackers have conferences too. And we share our knowledge. It's called B-Sides Tel Aviv. And we meet each summer at Tel Aviv University, right next to this, a statue of a Trojan cyber horse built from pieces of infected devices as a tribute to the cyber gods that we may never be infected again. You're welcome to join us. These events are all free and they're all international. But the truth is, when I go to hackers' conventions, when I go to DEF CON in Las Vegas, I don't see 30,000 criminals at the world's largest hacking event. I see the talent of our future. I see creative, passionate individuals that can help us save our future if we are able to think about them as allies instead of enemies. I see kids who go there with their parents because they believe being a hacker is a good idea for their future. And I feel the same way. Now the question is, how do you feel? Are you ready to take the red pill? Are you ready to wake up into the hacker's mindset and understand that this is what it takes to build a better future? Whatever you decide to do, choose wisely, because the future is in your hands alone. Thank you. Hack the planet!